Are you looking for advanced study techniques this fall semester so that you can crush it, get a good start, get better grades, stand out, highlight yourself to your professors so that you can get that internship, you can get that job down the road? Well, this video is for you. We're gonna go over 9 study techniques so that you can crush it in your engineering career. Hey, 1% Nation, I'm Jake Voorhees, and you are watching episode 41 of the 1% Engineer Show, where we empower young engineers to rise to the top 1% of their career. If this is your first time to the channel, guys, make sure you subscribe because I release videos 3 times per week about engineering student success. There's a lot of crappy study tips on the internet, stuff that is super basic, super boring, not really helpful, like don't procrastinate and study with friends. But I wanted to make this video to give you some more advanced techniques so that you can crush it, you can get good grades in your challenging engineering courses. So let's not waste any more time. Let's jump right into it with tip number 1. Set yourself up for classroom success. Preparing yourself for lecture is very important. I've talked about this before. This way you're not scrambling to pay attention in class. You're not actually seeing things for the first time. When you get to lecture, you looked into the material the night before, days before, you reviewed it, you familiarized yourself with it. So you're not just scrambling and playing catch up in the classroom. You're actually ready for those first questions. You're ready to apply it. And it just helps you lock in those lesson notes, those equations, those formulas, whatever you're learning in class that day, so much better because you've seen it before. Keep this in mind later on when we talk about the spaced repetition technique, where the more you see something with spaced repetitions and give yourself some time to let it sink in and have the neural connections actually fuse, then you will be better suited later on. So that's why you need to review the material before you even get to class so that the first time you're seeing this stuff isn't while you're in class. Step number 2, make sure you take good notes. And I'm gonna give you a specific tactic so that you can do this. Check out the Cornell method. This method was created by Walter Polk, who was a Cornell professor in the 1950s and wrote the book, How to Study in College. This note-taking technique divides your paper into 3 sections. The rightmost section is where you take all your notes. The leftmost column is where you do keyword summaries and little cues, questions. For example, you would talk about a keyword about a physics technique or like Newton's second law or something like this. And then you would have all the equations on the right side. And then at the bottom of the page, this is your 3rd section, you will summarize that page of notes. And this gives you so many advantages when it comes to studying, when it comes to doing your homework, because you can glance at the left column, you can glance down at your summaries, and then you can use the core section of your notes to actually call on the equations, look at the formulas, check out the information so that you can execute on your homework, study for that exam a little bit better. There's also a guided notes method, but studies have showed that the Cornell method is more dominant to this, so you can check out that other strategy if you choose, but I'm gonna suggest the Cornell method today. 3, habit forming. This is Charles Duhigg's book. He is an expert on habit. I've read this and I want to talk a little bit about how utilizing habit forming can actually help you when it comes to studying so that you don't procrastinate, so that you don't absolutely hate it and just get into a rut and stop studying, but you can create positive, healthy feedback loops for yourself so that you actually crush it when it comes to studying, when it comes to doing your homework. In his book, Duhigg talks all about the 3-pronged habit forming cycle. And what that is that you have a cue, you have a response, and then you have a reward. And a habit is grounded by these 2 other pillars. For example, a cue would be that you have a homework assignment coming up and it pops up on your schedule that you need to study, you need to do this homework. The action is what you do with it. It's either actually studying or maybe procrastinating. And then the 3rd one is the reward. And this is super duper important. If you're actually rewarding yourself every time you accomplish something great, like finishing a homework assignment on time or studying for an exam on time, then you need to make sure that you are rewarding yourself properly instead of doing the wrong execution and then rewarding yourself improperly. For example, what some students might do is the cue is they need to do homework, and instead of actually executing positively, they go to a party and then they're rewarding themselves by extra fun, maybe extra drinking, and they get into this negative cycle where instead of actually making yourself feel better and rewarding yourself with a positive accomplishment, you're committing to procrastination, you're committing to a negative feedback loop where you're going out with your friends, you're playing sports, you're going to a party or something instead of studying. So utilize tactics like only watching Netflix after you accomplish a homework assignment. Another example would be only allowing yourself to go to a party if you've already finished your homework, or each time you read a page in your textbook, you have a little tiny snack, make sure it's healthy so that you guys aren't crushing your total fitness. But investigate some of the summaries in this book and you will find that you can form very, very strong study habits that you can deploy in your life so that you're not procrastinating and you're actually positively rewarding yourself so much that you crave that feeling of accomplishment after you finish your homework, after you finish studying. 4, the Pomodoro Technique. And a good way to make sure that you're not burning yourself out, that you're not overcommitting and making yourself turn to procrastination is to deploy a technique like the Pomodoro Method. And what that is you chunk your time up such that you focus on something for 25 minutes with no distractions, and then you take a 5-minute break. And this falls right after the habit suggestion because that 5-minute break is the reward for committing yourself to a 25-minute study period, 25-minute homework execution period. And what they suggest with the Pomodoro Method is that you do 4 Pomodoro sections. So you do 25 with a 5-minute break, and then you do it again, and then you do it 4 times in a row. So that's 2 hours of studying, 2 hours of homework before you then reward yourself even further with a 15 to 20-minute break. This is where that Netflix episode comes in. This is where going outside and playing frisbee or going out for a little snack or something can come into play. But you have to deploy guidelines, study tactics like the Pomodoro Technique so you can stick to a plan so that you can follow a little system and you're avoiding distractions. And you try to get into that deep work for 25 minutes so that you can actually finish up your problems, so that you can actually have some studied information sink into your brain and allow those neural connections to be made while you're in that deep work zone for 25 minutes at a time. And while you're in the Pomodoro Method, what you need to do is write down any distractions that come into mind instead of looking at your phone, instead of Googling something. That way you get it out of your brain and you relieve yourself of that distraction. And over time, as you dig deeper and deeper and deploy the Pomodoro Technique over and over again, you will train yourself to avoid distractions and you'll get into that deep work zone so that you can crush it and accomplish all your tasks and become an A student. Check it out, guys. I highly encourage you to explore the Pomodoro Method. 5, study with a group, even if it's just one other person. It is very, very key to success because sometimes you will not get that homework assignment. Sometimes you will be caught up on an exam studying portion. So having someone else there to support you, or even for you to instruct, even for you to teach while you are studying is very, very important because in order for you to teach something, you have to understand it so thoroughly in order to write it down in a fashion where someone else can explain it. So it helps you understand something even deeper. It also may help you finish up that homework assignment a little bit faster. It may help you get to the bottom of an exam practice problem a little bit better when you're in a team. So I highly encourage you to work with people who are at the same student caliber as you. Don't work with someone who is so far ahead of you that they get frustrated and you don't want to be pulling people up from the bottom to where you are. Make sure you guys are peers in your classroom, academic peers, and the way that you stand out to better students is by participating in class, staying after class, meeting with the professor, and you guys will find each other. But I always, always encourage 1% Nation to find little study groups, 2, 3, 4 people max. Even 4 can be a little much. Maybe for an exam, 4 works out, but find other people who are the same status as you in your engineering road and study together. 6, spaced repetition. You heard me mention this earlier in this video, but studies have showed that if you introduce yourself to a topic, wait a little bit, introduce yourself again, wait a little bit, introduce yourself again, you actually can deploy fewer hours to your study commitment versus binge studying and trying to compact it all 2-3 days before an exam. You have to invest less time if you space it out, because what happens is, just like a muscle when you're working out, when you're going to the gym, your brain is the same. You show it something new, you learn something new, and you have to wait for all the neural connections to be made in your brain. And what happens is you have to forget a little bit of stuff to relearn it even faster. It's a lot like muscle building where you have to break it down and work that muscle out a little bit harder, damage it so that when it rebuilds, it's even stronger than before. The brain is the same. So studies have showed that you can invest significantly less time if you start studying for an exam weeks ahead of time, 2-3 weeks ahead of time, and study for just 1 hour, and then wait 3-4 days, and then study for 2 hours, and then wait 3-4 days, and then study for 2 hours again. And if you utilize these types of tactics, you are not only being more proficient with the way that you study, you're going to be more familiar, you're going to be more aware, you're going to have more baked in knowledge of these information pieces, of these equations, of these formulas that you learn in your engineering courses. And not only that, but you're going to have to invest less time to studying before you actually feel confident, before you actually know the methods, you know, the strategies for executing on equations. So highly, highly suggest that you guys look into space and repetition method so that you can be a better student in general. And seven, one thing to keep in mind is the power of diffused versus focused thinking. And there's a reason why I put this right after the space repetition method, because when we are concentrating with full force, when we are studying, when we're trying to learn, that is focused attention. And we're using the prefrontal cortex here, this front part of your brain, which is attention and learning. But actually it is other parts of your brain that hold memory. It's other parts of your brain that utilize all the neural connections. So you need to be thinking about these things in a non-focused setting as well, which is why the space and repetition method works so well. Because if you're just trying to overload in the very last minute and you're only utilizing focused attention and prefrontal cortex, very, very deep learning, then you're not actually building the connections in the best way possible. You need to give yourself breaks and allow yourself to sleep on things and allow yourself to think about stuff passively. While you're in the shower, you're going over very casually certain equations and certain problems, and you're trying to remember things, but you're not actually fully, fully focusing on these things. This way, you're allowing your focused attention and your diffused attention to come together and lock in those memories so that you can crush it when it comes to exam time. 8, destroy procrastination. Procrastination is the kryptonite of all students. Everyone would rather go for a walk, play video games, go out and get ice cream than actually doing your homework. But if you deploy micro tactics to slash that procrastination, you can be at an advantage to win. You have to break down your study tasks into the smallest microscopic details so that you can create a chain reaction of wins and get a good grade on your exam. Let me give you some examples here. If you have a macro goal of getting, say, all B's, all B pluses, all A's on your classes, then you're not actually giving yourself microscopic goals to get there. What you need to do is break that down into very, very small, manageable goals. You say, I'm gonna study for each class 3 hours a week, which means you're gonna have to employ about 45 hours of studying per week in total, assuming you have about a 15 semester credit load. So what you need to do is go into your calendar and block in study times and actually plan those out so that you stick to the plan, so that you break it down into these little tiny microscopic tasks, and then they build up to those good grades at the end of the semester. Because if you make these things too challenging for yourself and say, well, I'm gonna study for 8 hours on Saturdays and Sundays, those could be unmanageable tasks, and you're not actually breaking it up and splitting it up into actionable microscopic goals. And you could have a tendency to procrastinate if the goals you set for yourself are too hard, if you don't actually break it down into things where you can actually be successful, you can actually accomplish these little goals that build up into this big picture. You also don't want to put yourself in a situation where it's easy to fail in your goals. For example, this is why people go to the library to study. It's not that the library helps them study, it's that they are removing themselves from distractions. They won't be seduced into playing video games with their roommate, they won't be seduced into going out into some party. They're actually putting themselves in an environment where they know they can win. So I encourage you guys to do that. Don't always study in your dorm room. You should go to a library, you should go to a coffee shop with soft music or something and remove distractions so that you can kill it during your study time. And 9, the Corson method. And if you guys get stuck on something while you're studying for that exam, then what you need to do is make sure that you dive into it enough such that you write down all of the steps and you get to that stopping point, you get to that frustration point where you can't go any further. And when you do actually go ask for help, you can say, okay, I did this and I tried that and then I got to here and this is the part that I don't understand. What you're showing your professor, what you're showing your TA is that you have been ambitious enough to try it and you did deploy what they learned in class, but you got stuck here. And it shows that you tried. It also helps them help you because they know the exact source of the confusion. They know the exact source of frustration. So this is what you need to do, guys. You need to try it yourself first and then ask if you get stuck. Comment below and let me know which of the study tactics you like the most, what you're gonna deploy in your semester this year. And if you like this video, guys, consider subscribing because I release videos 3 times a week for engineering student success so that you can crush it in your career and become a 1% engineer. Thanks for watching the 1% Engineer Show, guys, and stay hungry on your quest to become a 1% engineer. Cheers!